Hi, this is Tracii Guns from LA Guns, and welcome to another episode of Riff Lords. And what we're going to do today is I'm going to go through some classic LA Guns riffs, and I'm going to play them a couple times for you, once fast, once slow, maybe a couple times slow, and have a good time with this. All right, so we're going to start off today with the very first song on the very first LA Guns record called No Mercy. And it was a song put together in the old Dolly Madison factory where we rehearsed in Silver Lake, California. Mick brought in the main riff, and we pounded it out in two straight 8-hour summer sessions with no air conditioning. So I will never forget putting this song together. And here's how it goes. So that's all the cool parts, and I'll slow it down and you can see what I'm doing a little bit better. And here we go. To get into what is all this mess in the key of A or A flat, depending on how you tune your guitar. It starts with an open A string, which is actually D, C. So you can picture it like bar chords, but you're leaving out the root. Be really nasty about it, you could just be. You can always do that. That's on you though. So that's that main part. And then when I've seen other people play the song during the verse part, there is a little change in it that happens that people, it's a nuance, and it's this chord, which actually is an E chord, but you're chugging along on A. What I'm doing there is I'm pulling off to G and back to A. Then E with an A over it. See that? So that's how that works. It all sounds simple, and it is, but it's those little stupid things I do that make it a little bit different and make it almost unlearnable on an album because there's another guitar going right over it. But that's all there. Okay, there's that. And then the chorus is simple. It's C, D, A, back to the main riff. So it's. Just to make it clear, After I recorded that little bit in the song every time, I've never been able to play it correctly again. So I will attempt to play it for you correctly. It's all trills, but I'm not fast enough anymore. But this is how it really goes. That's the original part on the record, but you got to play it like. Very difficult to play for me, probably easier for you, but that's how it goes. Then there's the, what you would call the transition part coming from the second verse, really, or from the intro to the song into the song. That happens a lot through the song. It even happens on the next string once. And what it is just a chromatic lick going down to A, to an open A, starting on an A here. That's chromatic, then chromatic from E, pull off C. That's all it is. When we were putting this song together and writing the first LA Guns record, our influences were were pretty focused. It was, you know, Rolling Stones, Johnny Thunders, LA hardcore punk scene, and Scorpions metal. Not that much of a Led Zeppelin influence on our first record, other than Bitches Back. So that's why, you know, it really has a kind of unique sound about it, because it's somewhere in classic rock, but it has a little bit more aggression, but not in so much of a metal way, but more of a punk rock aggression, or at least what people consider punk rock aggression, and a nasty sound, you know. Early on, when people would hear the band without seeing the band and all our lipstick and, you know, high hair and everything, we were often compared to Motorhead. But when I listen back now, I can understand because of the dirt and the dirty sound that we did have. But we were definitely coming from four or five different islands as a band writing the material. So everybody kind of brought what they were really into each song. And that's why it sounds the way it does. Next up, we'll do One More Reason to Die, which I wrote on the bass when I was 19, sitting in a really weird apartment somewhere deep in the valley, wondering where all my friends were. I remember it like it was yesterday. I was really into Motley Crue's first record, and I really liked, in particular, Take Me to the Top, PC Reaction, stuff like that. But all I had was a bass at this particular moment in time when I was writing. Then I took what I wrote and I put guitar to it, and this is what the guitar is like. Your verse and chorus parts. And when you hear it in this context without all the music and without me improvising all over it like I do live, you can really tell it's influenced by, you know, sweet early Motley Crue, that kind of thing. It really has a kind of snotty intention about it, you know, this the slide up. You know, that's some attitude right there, you know, switching chords like that. Always been one of my favorite things that Mick Mars did and Johnny Thunders did, was slide into chords. Brought that into rehearsal on a bass and showed Mick Cripps, said, hey, here's this thing I got. And I haven't played any guitar to it yet. And as soon as we got into it, we're like, yeah, you know, this is really cool. So I'm gonna play it again for you now slower. And this one's really easy. And you'll notice that there's more stuff on the first record in the key of A, or A flat, depending how your guitar is tuned, than stuff that's in E. There's some E stuff, but we were really in the going for the looks that kill sound. All right, so here we go. We'll be right back. just describing what's happening there is obviously this is an A chord. So you're sliding back and forth between A and G, pedaling on the A string open all the time. And we're back to that little, you know, half bar chord, which is a C. You know, that's another way you could approach it depending on how you voice your chord. But on the album, it's just straight ahead. And then when we get into the verse, the big chunky part, when we make the initial C chord, you're also gonna bar the G string. So it's really heavy. So it's C, G, A, but it's C with the G on top to start with. And then we do it going to F. Slide up to G. And the high A chord. Excuse me if I improvise a little bit when I play these. I really still enjoy playing the songs. Another feature is this pick slide that happens. So I learned how to do pick slides with, I don't know what you call this, that thing at the end of your pick slide. And I always do it that way. So it's like kind of an effect. It's a little bit more dynamic maybe. It's like two layers of getting into the next part. And with my right hand, particularly on this song, the muting is all over the place, the palm muting, because I just noticed when I was playing the intro part, I'm only muting the low string. And that mute happens in between every single change of that part. See that? Same in when we get to the verse part, I'm lightly muting. It's not so anymore. It's that would be heavily muted. So those mutes really happen on every chord change almost in the song. And I never really noticed it till we sat down to pick it apart. Any LA Guns song I've ever written and recorded, they're blueprints to go and do something later live with them. So have fun with the songs. You know, if you're playing this one, I mess up the rhythm and do really cool stuff with it live all the time. So these are all just blueprints. You do whatever you want with them, and those are the bones. Moving on to another song off the very first LA Guns record, and something we got a lot of requests for was Electric Gypsy. Again, it's in the key of A, and it's built around this little A chord that so far No Mercy and One More Reason to Die, it has existed there as well. So this is a little bit trickier because we're gonna do things built around this little chord. And I'll play it for you, the main riff. I'm gonna go to the bathroom. right, so we have a lot of elements of the last two songs going on in this song all at the same time. So I'll slow it down as I talk about these parts. So starting with the intro riff. So it's an open A, muting again. Going to this D chord, which also looks like this, but we're only playing this. And then we're making our little A chord. But we're only using it as a pull-off platform. So you're pulling off of the G string on the 9th fret back to the 7th fret. Very common in my genre of music. The next jump down is to C. Then quickly back up to D, pulling off on the 8th fret on the B string to the 7th fret. And then G string. So that's how that works. Then we get into the verse, which is just a straight open A string. So you're going to pull off of D, C sharp to open A. And end up on C sharp. Fairly straightforward. There's a little cool bit in the A that I like to do live, and so I'll play it. Instead of playing the open A, you can just play it on the E string. Right? But always just pull off on that. Or you can wait. Blueprints again. Do whatever you want with the parts. Now here comes the chorus that happens after that. What's happening there is the A is a standard A chord to open up the chorus. And obviously we jump down to G, F sharp, and F. And the first three times around, I just play the octaves of the chord, the root and the next high octave. Four, I only play the root and the fifth of the chord. So it really defines the difference and the dynamic that happens on the fourth time around is letting the listener know that you're about to change. So that's what's happening there. Not too much muting on this song. You know, this is one where it's more open, the chords are ringing, still a lot of low strings, but in the main riff is where we have our nice little pretty part. Also happened to be the last song that I wrote, the last piece of music I wrote for the first LA Guns record. We were actually in the studio recording the album. Somebody said, hey, we need one more song. And I rode my little Honda Rebel back to my apartment that night. I came up with these parts, brought them to the studio the next day, and we wrote Electric Gypsy. So getting back into why do I improvise all these songs live, and why is it just a blueprint, you know, when it's recorded and all that stuff. And for me, I grew up listening to guitarists like Hendrix and Randy Rhoads, Jimmy Page, guys like that, who never played the same thing twice. And those are the records I played along with, the live records, you know, Song Remains the Same, UFO with Michael Schenker, Strangers in the Night, the tribute record, Ted Nugent, Double Live Gonzo, Aerosmith, Live Bootleg. So when I would listen to that music, and that's what I was jamming along to, I noticed that those versions were so drastically different than the original studio recordings, that that's how I just thought it was done, is you write a song and then you go live and you do whatever you want over it. So generally, not every song lends itself to that. But definitely the first two LA Guns records, you know, those very hard-hitting, just slightly above medium tempo songs and the key of A and stuff, which is the easiest key for me to jam in. It just, it keeps it interesting for the musician that wrote it and played it and recorded it. Because, you know, who knows, you might still have to play those songs 35 years later, like I do. And I still love them just as much as I did then, because I get to improvise on it. I take my own license, and it doesn't always work, but most of the time it does. Now we're moving on to the Cocked and Loaded record, our second record, our first big budget, waste a ton of money on making a sleazy rock album. But the songs are great. Why don't we do Rip and Tear right now? That's the whole song, two chords, D and A. And then you do a bunch of weird stuff around those chords and it's still the song. So what we're doing, Mick and I had two very uncleverly different parts, you know, but they were different nevertheless. And in the intro, you play off the straight, pulling off that G. So you're actually pulling off the A to the G when you do the little switcheroo. Now Mick, when he played D, he would do it here. You see a little catch in there? Or if you're playing a full bar chord. C, B, obviously. But when I play it, when I'm chugging along, I play it more open, like this. Which the two ways of playing it together really complement each other and they make it sound really thick. So if you have two guitars, the Mick guy, he's gonna go. And the me guy is gonna go. Same chords, D, C, B. That's it. And then in the verse, we have the little sleazy parts, which are the. Right? What's happening there? Okay, so on the A, chugging along. And sometimes I accent with the high A with the pinky, which is actually E and A together. And then you do double stops. What's a double stop? We play two strings at the same time. And we do two sets of double stops in A and in D. So here's the first set. Once we get to D, very simple stuff. I mean, double stops are weird if you never played them before, but it gives you that sound. You know, it gives you a really rock and roll vibe that works great in this song. And then I throw in this little blues lick. Right, just walking up. So in the A, you're gonna hit a C and a C sharp up to the D chord. Right? Which I don't even know what notes those are. It's just too high up on the neck. It's F and F sharp off the D chord. In fact, you could go. You could play the same. Anyways, there's just little passing notes to get you from the chord changes. They don't happen every time on the album, but they do happen a couple times. And I wanted to let you know that they do exist if you never paid attention to them before. But Rip and Tear, Mick Cripps, came over to my house in Melrose District at 7:30 in the morning after his wife went to work when we were very young in our 20s. And he told me, we need a song like When the Whip Comes Down by the Rolling Stones. Those were his exact words. We need a song like that. And I thought to myself, oh, I guess we do, you know. And he had that riff, the very simple. You know, that's where the song started from. It's just that little thing there. And so what I did is I listened to the When the Whip Comes Down by the Stones, and I realized it never changed. You know, it just kind of like does this thing, and the whip comes down. And that was the highlight of the song, really. So I figured, okay, well, we should put some emphasis on this riff. I give a definition in between the parts, because everything that's happening is built around just two chords. With those little walk downs, a little blues lick, a little double stop thing. And it happens to be the third most popular LA Guns song of all time. So let's break down the intro riff to Rip and Tear really slow so you can really get the vibe and the feeling of what it is. And it starts with just an A chord. And you're gonna pull off this G. So let me play it for you, the whole thing really slow. The trickiest part of this is pulling off that G and not doing it weird, like, you know what I mean? That sounds like really sterile and stale, and it's wrong. So you gotta really yank on it to get it up to at least a G sharp. And whip that open G open. See that? So it's just built on this, you know, so A to G. Then when you come up to the D, it's D, C. But you always leave that root note from the D there. When when we were writing, particularly the first two LA Guns albums, was I had the benefit of Mick Cripps. He was my right-hand man, an overthinker, and I'm an underthinker. He would come in with these riffs occasionally that were very simple, but very catchy. You know, like Whole Lot of Love is very catchy, but it's just two notes. And having a relationship with another musician to where you're able to get, you know, he would give me seeds, you know, and not everybody gets seeds, you know. Mick would give me seeds and say, hey, I have this idea. Like here's a quick example of something that Mick brought in this riff for Face Down. Right? When he brought that in, I was like, where'd you get that? It's so cool, you know? So he definitely had this this cool sense of riffage and simplicity. Meanwhile, you know, I'm studying, you know, classical music and listening to Randy Rhoads and Ritchie Blackmore and all that stuff. And he's keeping my head on the ground. You know, it's like, okay, that stuff's great, but, you know, do that. And it's interesting, you know, to respect somebody enough as a lead guitarist with a massive ego, which I do have, and I did have then. I respected him enough to listen to him. And is he a great player? In his way, you know, same way Keith Richards is a great player. And he was able, between him and I, we were able to really create the vibe of those first two albums, you know, and that really, what people consider a sleazy rock sound, an LA sound, which was really a hybrid sound, you know, because we weren't full on hair metal, glam metal, alternative, funk, but we had elements of all those things in our music and with our image. We were easily as into the Lords of the New Church as we were into Motley Crue, but image wise, they were similar, you know? And image was very important back then. And those are the things that I learned from Mick about a band should look cool, a band should sound cool. That's kind of where he was at, you know? And then I was more, yeah, but a band should be musical, you know? So we had that chemistry as writers, and then you put Phil on top of it. It's just like, wow. You know, when you got a singer like that, you can write anything and it's gonna sound good. You know, so I don't know if this stuff's really that good or not, but I know when Phil sings it, everything came together. And it's important to respect your bandmates. All right, while we're on Cocked and Loaded, let's stay in the key of A. And Never Enough, another song built off the little mini A chord. And I'm gonna play it for you and then we'll talk about it. That's how that's played. That's what that looks like. And that is the correct tone for that song. Let's break it down slow. I don't want to drag these things out really long. So I'm going to do the parts without a super amount of dialogue. Here we go. That's the intro, and it's also the part that happens before the chorus. And what it is once again, we're on an A string open. D chord, but just a little part. Mini A bar chord. Slide down to the little C. And then you're gonna pick your fingers off, and you're gonna have a G chord in the middle. So like this. Which almost doesn't make any sense, but it works really well in that riff. Right? So it's basically A, D with an A over, A, C, G. So if you leave out all the little frilly bits, it sounds like this. This is almost the same thing. It's easier to play that way, obviously. And then we get into the heavy E riff. I go up, slide along the string from G into E. Right, so low E, high E. D, C sharp. Again. A. E. So here's the whole riff. Slide into the verse, instead of hitting an open E, you do this weird G, which is also an E7. Or it could be played in two places. The voicing's a little different. So. Pretty straightforward. So if you want to look fancy and you're playing in a cover band, you can switch up those E chords. Like same chord. Now we have the chorus, which on the record isn't very fancy, but it has impact. And the way that I just played it earlier is how I play it live with all the passing notes. So I'll show you the basic chords from the record. And that's just C to G to D to A. And then in the middle, you do that little walk up, which is A, B, C. So that's pretty straightforward. And I'm going to show you what I do when I play it live, is I actually play the chords more open. So you can tell there's a big difference in opening the guitar up when you play the open chords, which is something Angus Young would do. You know, he loved. Instead of. In a two-guitar band, it's great to have each guitarist doing the different type of chord to really thicken things up. But that is the bulk of Never Enough, and that was the first time we had ever written with outside writers for the lyrics and stuff like that. And it was a cleaner, slicker, less sleazy sound for LA Guns. But everybody loved it, you know, so we didn't complain. I mean, I complained when the suggestion came up, like, we don't need to write with anybody. But we did, and we had great success with it. And that's Never Enough. Okay, now here it comes, Ballad of Jayne. Before we get into it, this was on our second record on Cocked and Loaded. I really protested against this song. I liked the song. I thought it was a hit song and all that stuff. I thought it was too early in our career to be putting, you know, that type of ballad on an album, you know. I wasn't ready to give in to the obvious, you know. I wanted to work a little harder, you know. I wanted to pound it into people, you know. I mean, I was 22 years old when we were recording Cocked and Loaded, and I wasn't ready to do that yet. However, meeting after meeting after meeting with our management and everything, we recorded it. It was originally called She's So Cold. It's about those pictures you see in like the, you know, the laundromat or the dry cleaners, you know, the people on the wall. They have all these 8x10s, you know, local celebrities and stuff like that, but you don't know who they are. So they're Jane Doe's and John Doe's. And that's what the lyrics are about. They're about, who is that Jane? Who's that unknown person on the wall? What happened to her? Because obviously she didn't become famous the way she wanted to. The common myth about the lyrics of the song is that it's about Jane Mansfield being decapitated. And yeah, that's romantic and stuff, but that's not what the song's about. Anyways, here it is. Here's Ballad of Jayne. That's all the important parts of the song. I'll show you what they are. And that little intro, Mick Cripps came up with that really cool open C to D thing. I had never seen anything like it. And this is what it looks like. It's, you're playing a C chord without any middle. So you slide from C to D. And then you play this D. Open G, back to the C, just C, two C, into G. So I know a lot of people struggle trying to figure out what that very simple sounding thing is. So it's that weird C, you know, figure like this, but you remove the middle of the chord. into G. And the rest of the song is really straightforward. You know, it's G to C, G to C, G to C, E. So here we go. Check it out. Like an old-fashioned country song or even a Rolling Stones style ballad, because it is in the key of G major, which gives you all the twangy bits, right? It has that feel. That's the intention of the song. So obviously you can improvise like crazy over this one, but that's really all there is to it. It's a simple song with a little tricky, weird sounding intro. And that song went on to make us be able to play today. It exploded. It was a huge hit. And I'm very grateful now. I'm glad we put it out. And I know that you guys liked it. Okay, so now we're at the fourth LA Gun studio record, Vicious Circle. And we're going to get right into a heavy track called Killing Machine, which was named after a band that I was also in at the time, a side project. And it kind of represents the whole, that whole time. Here we go. It was heavy, it was in your face, it was a new time for LA Guns, it was a new beginning for rock once again. You know, this is around 1993, 94. We had become a more aggressive band. We also were angry, and some of the guys were doing a lot of drugs and stupid stuff, and things were falling apart, which is a great chapter in any legendary rock band's book. So I guess we had to do it too, because that's just the way it goes. But this song was a product of that. And a lot of the music I've written since this particular song has been built around this figure, which is a half step. So we're so heavy, so cool. On an acoustic guitar, on a ukulele, on a, you know, my Les Paul. Always heavy, this half, you know, step thing. So that's what Killing Machine's based around, and chromatics. Chromatic, one note after the next, yeah. Things that are heavy. Put that in your little, you know, learning trick box. Things that are heavy. half steps, and chromatic. Also, in that same thing, without getting complicated, diminished things, whole step, half step, whole step, half step. Those are heavy stuff like that. Anyways, so Killing Machine, here's the riff. So what's happening there is you could almost take this root away to learn what the song is doing. Right? Because it's just this C to B. But we build it off this little E chord here. Which could also be played here. Stuff like that. And then get into the verse. It's the chromatic part that we talked about a second ago. Randy Rhoads stuff. That is the chorus part, the last place that last piece I played. You'll notice that it has it's in the key of E, but it's going up only a half step. Which is interesting and dark and dirty and heavy. And then it just goes back down the E minor scale with the chords. It's D, C, B, so. Now we're gonna do a song from the Missing Piece album. This is the reunion record, the first reunion, the first time that Phil and I had written songs and recorded an album in 12 years. And the song is called Speed. It was an old piece of music that I had written from 2008 that I found on my computer in a folder that said horrible sounding 80s riff. I didn't remember it when I saw it, but I opened it up, I put it on, I was like, oh, yeah, that doesn't sound so horrible anymore, you know, 10 years later. So I completed writing the whole piece of music, got it to Phil, and we now work with a guy named Mitch Davis, an awesome lyricist. And we put this song together, and I'll shut up now and I'll play it for you. What is this really bad sounding 80s metal riff? Well, it really isn't. It's in the style of Randy Rhoads, actually. It's very similar to Diary of a Madman, which was... Right? So that's my favorite piece of rock music ever written. So I do a lot of things with that figure. Right? And so it's built off of that, straight up. So you can hear it in there. It survives in within the riff a little bit. And I'll slow it down and I'll show you exactly what I'm doing. I'll explain it very briefly musically how it works. So here's the riff slow. Very Diary of a Madman. Then you jump down to F. Always plucking the root. G. So it's G, B, C, D. So really, in a way, if I just stayed in the same position the whole time, it would be like... pretty on its own, but we were trying to make a metal song, you know? And so I just took, right? Lower the root and lower the riff. So it only happens pretty once. So it gives a really full dynamic range and not just so samey. I could also do it all low. But that tonally, right in the middle of the neck as a mid-range instrument, just works so good. Brought that riff in, and then we just pedal on the A, still with the kind of Randy Rhoads lick for the verse. And what that is it's that same phrase, except now we're doing something off the early LA Guns records. We're pulling from A to G, back to A. So it's the riff, and then you just pull off A to G, back to A. Then the turnaround is really interesting, really fun, is we're gonna play an F chord, a C chord, and a G chord back to A, but our F chord is gonna be a high F with a C barred on top of it. So I'm gonna get us into the part. Okay, so it's really cool that high F chord with the C on top. Otherwise, it would just sound like this. Which is very heavy, but this is just something so spectacular about it. Working within the context of the rest of the... It's in the same frequency range. It works together. It flows. It has a definite thing about it. So we get through this. Now, what's really cool about this part is it really shifts in what I call, in metal, the organic halftime move, where everything's clipping along. And all of a sudden you shift it. And what that is that the tempo is exactly the same. It's that you cut the time in half. That's what happens with this part. Except it's a completely different piece of music. so it doesn't sound like we were playing one thing and then decided to change the tempo, really cut the tempo in half. We just inserted another piece of music there and it flows really nice. And it starts on C and the key's in A, so it's still relatively the same thing. Because when you have A, that's A and C together. It's the same thing. I should say A minor and C. So we're clipping along. Okay, so when we get to this part, do you remember when I was talking about the snotty push and One More Reason to Die? Okay, now this has a bunch of snotty pushes in it. So you're actually pushing back and forth from the C to D up to the F to the E. So it's like. Did you catch that? Let's do it slow. And live, that kicks in like a freight train. And those are the cool parts of speed. All right, and last but not least, in this session of Riff Lords, I'm demonstrating this one because this is one that I really love. And it's one of the only times I've written a riff that was difficult to play for me after I had written it. Because generally when I write something, I'll make a quick demo of it. And then I won't revisit it until the band gets together to rehearse and do pre-production for recording. So this one, in that case, was difficult to play, and it's called Gone Honey. And here's what the riff sounds like. Those are the parts of Gone Honey, and I'll slow down the intro riff for you. It is tricky to play. It's still tricky for me to play because of your hand movements are very unnatural from what you normally play as a blues or metal guitarist. And here it goes. So it's in A. Simple enough, right? Okay, but now we're gonna play a C over that. How did that work? Okay, A. So basically, I never stop playing the A chord. I only add the C, and it goes up. Watch again. Essentially, it's A, C, D, but what happens is when we form the C over the A chord, what's that? That's a B chord. So we have C, A, and B all happening simultaneously with a little E in there. So it's a very strange chord. Those two notes are only one half step away from each other. It's almost like playing those two notes together at the same time. So it'd be... So musically, it's not supposed to work, but in this riff, it does. That's why it's the most interesting to me, because it's the only time I've ever played two notes that are a half step apart from each other at exactly the same time, and it doesn't sound like... All right, so going through the riff really quick one more time. That'll keep you busy for a while trying to get that together. Maybe some of you will get lucky and it'll come right away. And I hope it does. Next part is just this straight ahead A major bar chord that you open up, and it sounds like this. C, same thing. Second position bar chord D with an A. Then F, E. A. Now the chorus is this little, just as in Speed, we have the little F chord with a C on top. Then C to A minor. To F. Back to the riff. When you're learning to play guitar, and you're watching this video, that means you're into rock music. And the exciting thing about rock music is that most of us have somebody we looked up to or somebody that inspired us to want to play rock music. Right off the top of my head, you know, the first thing is it's easier for some people than it is for others. But like anything else, if you love something that you're doing, you're going to put the effort in, you're going to put the time in to really satisfy your need to create and to create music and to be proud of yourself secretly, you know, I mean, the guitar players, we're very proud of ourselves outwardly, but it's supposed to be inwardly. Try to remember that the most satisfying part of playing any instrument is when you've achieved a little tiny goal, when you're finally able to fret a B7 chord effortlessly. You know, something that small is such a big goal. So I encourage you to make your fingers hurt, get the callus build up. You have YouTube as your best friend in the world right now for learning how to play styles and things and techniques. Jamming along with friends, jamming along with things on YouTube. These are the things that are gonna get you ahead quickly. Frustration is part of it. Getting stuck in a rut is part of it, but you break through those things, you know, and a good way to break through, you know, ruts and stagnant periods of learning how to play rock guitar is to listen to different styles and learn different styles. But I encourage anybody that loves to play and is determined to play to stick it all out, and you know, you will see a light at the end of the tunnel. And when you start seeing that light, then you start chasing that light and you're never gonna get it. All right, well, this concludes this episode of Riff Lords, and I really hope you dug it. I dug it. It's something I've never done before, and I hope we can do it again, and I'll see you all soon.